Hello, I'm John Woodward. I'm glad to join you by way of this teaching session in the Fermata. We're going to be talking about taking up your cross daily. This is a truth that has been very meaningful in our ministry here in our biblical counseling and training. We emphasize the victorious life as it relates to solving life-controlling problems. I'm so thankful that the Lord Jesus came to heal the brokenhearted, to set at liberty those who are captive, to give new sight to blind eyes, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. We not only see a breakthrough and freedom in people's lives when they appropriate Christ as their Lord and in their life and their liberator, we also see the need for cultivating this abiding life on a day-by-day basis. Years ago, when I was discipling a man who had chronic problems, I noticed that he would make progress during our discipleship time, but then he would regress during the week. And so as I sought God's wisdom on how to encourage him to abide in Christ in a more intentional basis, this outline started to emerge. It became very meaningful to me as I reflected on Luke chapter 9, verse 23. And Jesus said, "If anyone will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me." In the Fermata notes, you'll see an outline that's been developed over the years as we consider that there's three different aspects of how we are made. We have, in the words of 1 Thessalonians 5:23, that we have our spirit, our soul, and our body. And we believe that through our human spirit, we can relate to God. Through our soul, or the seat of our personality, we can relate to others. And with, of course, our body, we relate to the world around us. And then we're holistic as those made in God's image, and we also have relationships with others. As I did research for a book I wrote years ago called Man as Spirit, Soul, and Body, I noticed that this was the view of the early church, the view of Martin Luther, and it gave additional clarity to different sanctification concepts in the New Testament. So in this outline, we're going to look at the difference between how we are spiritually saved when we're born again. Our physical body will be resurrected at the second coming of Christ. Romans 8 calls that the redemption of our body. But in James chapter 1, we have a verse that says that we are to receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save our souls. I think that fits well with what we're saying, that our soul would include the faculties of mind, will, and emotions. And as I think about this daily aspect of the cross, I believe it's helpful to see the distinctions that can be made in terms of our spiritual life, our psychological life, our physical life. Now, some Bible teachers would view this differently and see that the soul and spirit are just different words for the same aspects of man. In that case, they would maybe use this teaching and make spirit and soul just adjectives: spiritual, psychological. So if you want to use adjectives, you have permission to do so. I'm going to be using nouns because I think Hebrews 4:12 bears that out, that the word of God is living and powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing of soul and spirit. And so we're going to be talking about the soul in terms of faculties of the mind, the will, the emotions, and the affections. When we think about the daily aspect of the cross, we want to put this in the context of the overall theme of the cross in the New Testament. There are different themes about the victorious Christian life. Some themes include the abiding life theme. Another theme is the crucified life theme. And of course, there's the spirit-filled life theme. All of them are wonderful aspects of the victorious Christian life. I would suggest to you that the abiding life in John 15 emphasizes the Father's role as the vine dresser. I believe the crucified life emphasizes our union with Christ and his work on the cross. And the spirit-filled life theme, of course, relates to the Holy Spirit taking control and empowering us. This teaching is about the daily aspect of the cross. And when we read 1 Corinthians chapter 1, we learn that the cross is the wisdom and power of God. In other words, what Christ did on Calvary may look foolish or weak by human standards, but according to God's providential design, the cross is the wisdom and power of God. We find that true in discipleship counseling also. People try psychiatric medications, they try psychotherapy, they try self-help, they try just strengthening themselves in spiritual disciplines, but often they become very discouraged and they wonder, how can I have the power and freedom to be free of life-controlling problems? We believe that the cross is the wisdom and power of God in discipleship and also in counseling. For example, if someone doesn't know the Lord Jesus, the first aspect of the cross is what we might call the cross of redemption, where the Bible says that through Christ's death on the cross, He paid the price so that we could be redeemed. The second aspect of the cross, and the others I'm going to mention, are really the believer's cross, our response to the finished work of Christ. And I believe that there are four different aspects of the cross in the life of the believer. And as I've studied this theme and discipled people over the years, these four themes of the cross in the life of the Christian have become more and more meaningful to me. We could call one aspect of the cross for the Christian the cross of consecration. If I would give you a Bible verse for that, it would be Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. You know it well. I urge you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your body a living sacrifice. That's written to believers, and it talks about our wholehearted surrender to God, motivated by His mercy. Another aspect of the believer's cross is what we might call the cross of identification. I would summarize that with Galatians 2, verse 20. I, as a believer, have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. The life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me. So, in addition to the finished work of Christ, the work of redemption, which gives us salvation by grace through faith, the believer's cross is consecration, identification. The third aspect of the believer's cross is liberation. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, it says that Christ triumphed over Satan at the cross. Aren't you thankful that because we have a risen Savior who is exalted to the right hand of the Father, we have authority over Satan and the demonic realm? We can submit to God and resist the devil, and the devil has to flee from us. Colossians 2, verse 15, Christ triumphed over Satan at the cross. And then we come to the aspect of the believer's cross that this teaching is about. And I call this the cross of devotion. The cross of devotion is our daily cross that Luke chapter 9, verse 23 mentions, where our Lord says, if we would come after Him in wholehearted discipleship, we are to deny ourselves, take up our own cross daily, and follow Him. But we might ask the question, what does it mean for me to take up the cross? Is the cross just a general symbol for suffering and affliction? Well, sometimes we think of it that way, don't we? We have a difficult situation, a health problem, a difficult person that we have at our church, and we think, oh, that's just my cross. But I believe that the essence of the cross, in terms of the meaning of the cross, is this phrase, not me, but God, in spite of the cost. Not me, but God, in spite of the cost. We see that that theme is true in each one of the aspects of the cross I've been talking about. So now let's consider this daily cross, and we're going to consider not me, but God, in spite of the cost. The cost is costing us our independence, the independent way. We are prone to think and to choose and to feel and to delight in things that are independent of God. The Bible calls these independent patterns the flesh. And you and I have a daily choice where we can either walk according to the Spirit or walk after the flesh. This outline is another tool to describe the Spirit-filled life, the crucified life, the abiding life on a daily basis. And I hope it will be a helpful tool and way of outlining this very profound teaching in the New Testament. You'll see in your Fermata notes that we have this written out, and I'm going to mention four affirmations that have been meaningful to us. And this first affirmation is that we need to take up the cross in relation to our mind. We're going to talk about the faculties of mind, will, emotions, and affections. So with the mind, we might say, not my natural perspective, but may God's perspective determine my thoughts. You know, we are prone to look at life, to look at ourselves, to look at our responsibilities just from a human perspective. But the Bible says that God's ways are much higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. So not only do we need to have God's perspective when we preach a sermon or when we're doing a Bible study, but we need to have God's perspective day by day, morning, noon, and night. So here in your outline, we're going to give affirmations, and we have Bible verses for each. And we see here that the first affirmation, I have been united with Christ in my spirit. I've been united with Him in His death, in His burial, in His resurrection, and His ascension. I am now a branch. Christ is the true vine. And so we see that from John 15. Christ is the true vine. We are branches. Another affirmation, Christ in me is the hope of glory. Colossians 1:27 says that. God completely accepts me in Christ. I have a new identity in Christ. You see, we often live out of an identity based on what other people have said or how we feel or our position. But God says our identity is based on our position in Christ. The fact that we are born again, that makes us saints, sons and daughters of God. And that's a positive and unshakable, secure identity. That's God's perspective, and it's the perspective that you and I need. Another affirmation, I am free from sin's authority. Sometimes we don't feel that way. Sometimes we get stuck in a sin-confess cycle. But God says He has broken the authority of sin in our lives. As we walk in the Spirit, we can walk in victory one day at a time. So we need to respond this way to say, Lord, I want to surrender my flesh-based perspective, and I want Your perspective all day long. Amen? Another aspect of the daily cross, not only your mind, but also our will, the choices we make. And our prayer would be, not my natural will, but may God's will be done in my life. We recognize that prayer, don't we? Our Lord Jesus Christ prayed that in the Garden of Gethsemane. He said, Father, if there's any other way for this cup to be delivered from me, yet may not my will, but may yours be done. The Lord Jesus prayed that. Not my will, but yours, Father, be done. If Jesus prayed that, how much more do you and I need to pray it? He took the cup. He went to the cross for you and me. So affirmations that deal with the daily cross as it relates to our will would include, I surrender all my rights to God. He is my vindicator. I give up independent control of my life to God. I yield to God's good, acceptable, and perfect will. And we have scriptures in your notes for each one of these that you can meditate on and pray through. The response is, will we surrender to God's will in every area of our life? Now, I'm not saying that surrender is something that we can do in our own strength. None of these aspects of the daily cross add to the finished work of Christ. He said, it is finished. Our salvation is complete. Hallelujah. We're saved by grace. But it's the Holy Spirit who works in us. Philippians 2:13 says, it is God who works in us, both to will and to work for His good pleasure. And He works in us to delight in God's will. As our Lord Jesus said, I've come to do Your will. Your law is in my heart. See, our new human spirit, our new nature, delights in the law of God. And so we are called upon to deny our tendency to have an independent, stubborn will and instead yield it to God out of gratitude, out of wisdom, and out of cooperation with Him. So our response is, Lord, I want to surrender to Your will in every area of my life. Would you agree? This is not only our salvation experience, it's not only our baptism, it's not only our call to ministry, it's a daily decision you and I make to say, Lord, I yield to You today, Your agenda, Your leading, Your will be done. Amen? The third aspect of the daily cross is the cross applied to our emotions. When we think of our emotions, we think of happiness, sadness, anger, joy, whatever. These are like a nerve system in your soul. We think of nerves in our physical body, which would have pain or pleasure, hot, cold. Well, our emotions are I would consider them as a psychological nervous system that compares our perceived circumstances with our perceived resources. If I have a danger, a stress, a problem, and I don't think I have the resources to handle that, then my emotions are going to be upset, fearful, upset, angry, and so forth. But on the other hand, if I know that my resources in Christ are more than adequate for the problems that face me, then I can say with Paul, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Paul and Silas could be thrown into a Philippian jail and sing praises to God at midnight because they knew that greater is the Holy Spirit in us than the one who is in the world. So that's what I mean by the cross applied to our emotions. We're not saying that we deny our emotions, but we're saying we want to raise our awareness that God is adequate for any circumstance. And when we know that, then we're going to have a supernatural perspective, a supernatural enablement to have joy even in times of sadness, of having hope even in times of discouragement. And so here we have some affirmations. I rely on Christ in me. God will meet all my ultimate needs. My adequacy comes from Him. I will not rely on my coping mechanisms. God's love will compensate me for human rejection. I will wait upon the Lord. So as we yield to the Lord and trust Him, we have the awareness of His ability, His power in us, which gives us joy and peace and comfort, and it gives us emotional stability instead of being up and down based on our circumstances. Our response could be, I want to fully depend on the resources of the indwelling Christ for daily living. Amen? And then the fourth aspect of the daily cross I'd like to discuss with you is the cross applied to our affections. I'm going to define affections as the faculty of our functional heart, the seat of our affection, the seat of our motivation, the seat of our reflection. Our functional heart is the innermost part of us as to what we really delight in. And our Lord Jesus, quoting the Old Testament, says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And so when we talk about affections, we're really talking about what we delight in, what we value, what we treasure. And I believe that the aspect of the cross that deals with this could have this prayer, not my natural values, but may God's values motivate me. We need a value adjustment to have God's values as what we treasure and appreciate. Affirmations that you can consider about this aspect of the daily cross. I respond to God's love by loving Him with all my heart. Losing my independent life for Christ's sake, I find it. I look to eternal things for lasting significance. I set my affection on things above where my Savior is seated. I lay up treasures in heaven where my heart is focused. My ultimate aim is to be conformed to the image of Christ. To live as Christ and to die as gain. The purpose of my life is to bring glory to God. I desire to be a good steward of my time, my talents, and my treasures. Our response could be, will you delight yourself in God and His ultimate plan for your life? We need to delight in God. We need to value what He values. And these affirmations and Bible verses remind us that each day we have to choose. Are we going to value the empty, temporary things that the world is motivated by? Or are we going to be motivated by the glory of God and His kingdom values? In that way, we'll be a steward so that our material perspective, our use of time, our use of our talents will be in the context and in the right perspective to have eternal values as our ultimate motivation. Well, we've talked about these four faculties of the believer's soul, and we've said with our mind, we can say, Lord, not my perspective, but I want God's perspective to determine my thoughts today. In terms of our will, we can pray, not my independent natural will, but I want God's will to be my direction and my source of decisions today. And then we also want to say, not my resources, but may God's resources be my supply, my adequacy so that I can have joy and peace no matter what my circumstances may bring. And then finally, in terms of our affections, with our heart, we say, Lord, I want to delight in eternal values. I want to love you as I respond to your love and be motivated by eternal values so that that becomes my ultimate goal. When I think of the significance of the daily cross for victorious living, I'm reminded of Andrew Murray from South Africa. Over a century, he wrote about this theme, and just a quote from his book called God's Best Secrets. He says this, "This theme of the daily cross is a deep spiritual truth. Think and pray over it, and the Holy Spirit will teach you. Let the disposition of Christ on the cross, his humility, his sacrifice of all worldly honor, his spirit of self-denial, take possession of you. The power of his death will work in you, and you will become like him in his death, and you will know him and the power of his resurrection." Likewise, the apostle said, always caring about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus. And as that happens, the life of Christ will be manifested in our mortal body. Yes, sometimes the daily cross will also include physical afflictions. As Paul said in Colossians 1, that he was encountering even in his own flesh, in his body, what was lacking in the sufferings of Christ. He's not saying that he added to the finished work, but he's saying in his obedience as a Christ-centered disciple, he experienced physical sufferings, and you and I have that liability as well. And Jesus says, if you're persecuted for righteousness' sake, rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. An old hymn says, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me and for you. God bless you as you consider this outline for your personal development, your discipleship, perhaps your preaching, that it would be used of God to help us to appreciate that we can rest in Christ as our life and abide in Him day by day for the glory of God. God bless you.